So here we can see the topic that we have discussed, right? The Fourier series, and we have seen the continuous time for continuous time periodic signals. What we had something called as Fourier series. As you can see, Fourier series coefficients is what we got here. So it's all about representing the signal x of t in terms of and complex sinusoids. Okay, weighted superposition of complex sinusoids. You can see these are the complex sinusoids, which are of omega naught, the fundamental frequency, and its multiples. Okay, and then this is the Fourier coefficients, what we call. Then we have is what we have is something for the discrete time periodic signals. For discrete time periodic signals, we have something called as discrete time Fourier series. But then I saw your syllabus. Discrete time Fourier series, by the way, is not in your syllabus. That is why what we'll do, let us not put much effort into the discrete time Fourier series because it is not in your syllabus. Okay. So what we'll do is let us just then the remaining two things that are there in the Fourier analysis, which comprise of module 4, are the Fourier transform, which again is for continuous time aperiodic signal or non-periodic signals, and there is discrete time Fourier transform, the DTFT, which is for discrete time non-periodic signals. Okay. So but what I will be doing is before going to the Fourier transform or discrete time Fourier transform, what I will do is right from Fourier series, I will be going to the Z transform. Okay, X of Z, that's what we will be doing. Okay, so once we are comfortable with the Z transform, then we will be studying the discrete time Fourier transform. And finally, we will end in the continuous time Fourier transform. Okay, that's what I have in mind. Okay, so let us see, what did you understand by Fourier transform, the continuous time Fourier series? So before I want before jumping to the Z transform, I just want to make sure that whether you got the idea about the Fourier analysis or not. Okay, so let us go ahead and see. So the Fourier series, you can see, by the way, the whole Fourier series from various examples, what we saw, well, one thing was confirmed that Fourier series was discrete. That means we got x of k coefficient for k equal to 0, 1, 2, 3, right? They were existing for discrete intervals of time, and it was non-periodic in nature. Okay. Whereas the discrete time Fourier series was, in fact, was discrete, but it was periodic in nature. Okay, it could be periodic in nature. Okay, anyway, let us continue with what all things. So this was the formula for the Fourier series. So as you can see, because x of t was periodic, we had this divided by t for a single period, and because x of t was continuous, we had the integration, and because x of k was discrete, here we had a summation. Okay, this is also one more clue for you guys to remember. Okay, because when you understand, when you study Fourier series, then the discrete time Fourier series and Fourier transform, right? Discrete time Fourier transform, you tend to get confused. So I do not want you to get into that confusion. Okay, so this was a numerical, by the way, and I think this particular problem was not solved as part of the textbook, the problem that is solved in the class, but it was there in the introductory video. But what is the typical method, by the way? So what you do is you take one particular period, of a periodic signal, and try to represent it and start integrating in for one particular cycle, and you get try to get your answer. Okay, so here you can see, what's the clue? Any clue here? Yes, here is the clue. You can see the spacing is from 0 to t. Okay, the spacing is from 0 to t. You can see minus t to ts, ts to Here you can see this spacing is also T S. So one thing is for sure, the period here is a T. Okay, the period here is T, and you are supposed to integrate from minus T by 2 to T by 2. But then, since these values are zeros in nature, you will integrate only from minus T S to T S. Okay, So this was an introductory, the first problem. I hope you might have gone through this as a part of the, you know, I had asked you earlier. So what was the tricky part in this particular problem, by the way? Yeah, you see here, nothing much specific, minus Ts to Ts you integrate, end up getting a formula here. So whenever you see a complex exponential, you always try to combine them, okay, in the form of either e to the power j theta plus e to the power minus j theta divided by 2, or e to the power j theta minus e to the power minus j theta divided by 2j. So here we ended up getting, so whenever the authors frame these kind of questions, they make sure you end up getting these kind of answers only, some standard formula, okay, for the understanding. So luckily here you can see e to the power j minus j, you ended up getting this particular answer. And there is one place where you can always go wrong. So this particular thing, what the answer, whatever we got here, if at all we substitute, see, then there is k, right? So you will be asked to find k. So for what values of k you are supposed to find x of k? Usually you are expected to find the values for 0, then plus or minus 1, plus and minus 2, plus and minus 3, and so on. At least you are supposed to give an expression for that. But then as it happens, here you can see for this particular question, if at all I substitute k equal to 0, I get a 0 by 0 in indeterminate format. That is why this formula here is valid for all the values of k except 0. For k equal to 0 case, usually what we'll do is we do the substitution here. For k equal to 0 case, we do the substitution here itself in the beginning of the expression before doing the actual integration, right? So you can see here in this particular expression, if at all I substitute k equal to 0, I end up getting a 1, right? I end up getting a 1, which I can integrate, okay? So it will be a simple substitution. 1 integrated with dt is nothing but a t, okay? So this is one particular trick, and mostly this is where we tend to make mistakes. Okay, so for k equal to 0, you can see what just happened here. For k equal to 0 case, as you can see, this entire term turned out to be 1, which was integrated. So ts minus of minus ts, so 2ts divided by t. So we got two expressions here, you can see. We got two expressions here. So 2ts by t. So I hope you got this particular thing. Okay, so that is why for k not equal to 0, we have this particular expression. For k equal to 0, we have 2ts divided by t. Then any other interesting questions? Yes. Then you can see second type of problems. In the previous problem, you can see how many values, by the way, did we get here? As you can see here, the input was a rectangular box. Okay. The input here was a rectangular box, and its output, I will show you how does it look like. Let me go here, if at all I have the figure. Once again. Okay. So here you can see. So the output of this particular sync wave, right? That's what this particular wave was here. Once again. Yes, you can see this particular signal was a rectangular signal, right? You can see this particular thing looks like a rectangle. And the second thing that you want to observe here is there is a sudden transition here. So the sudden transitions are not good, and they are notorious for introducing lots and lots of frequencies. A sinusoidal waves, you might have seen, right? They are very, very smooth transition, slowly changing, right? Whereas this is abrupt transitions. So abrupt transitions are supposed to contain lots and lots of frequencies, as evident by this particular diagram here. And you can see in this particular diagram, it is going to give you an expression something like, for k equal to not equal to 2 Ts by Ts in the beginning, then afterwards, values that are going to decay, something like this. Okay, you are going to get a value, something like this. It is going to be a sort of a sinked wave. So a sinked wave is nothing but a sinusoid which has an envelope, something like this. Okay, which goes on decaying. Okay, remember, for rectangular sort of signals. And what is the other thing? You can see here, it's going to have lots and lots of inputs, k equal to 0, k equal to 1, k equal to 2, k equal to 3, k equal to 4. It goes on having lots and lots of impulses, indicating the presence of so many number of frequencies. Fine. That's what a Fourier series did. Okay. What Fourier series does, so you can see, this will be my x of k, and the x-axis is k. Now somebody told that Fourier series is going to convert the data from time domain to frequency domain. Where is the frequency? Remember this k here. Okay, so k indicates the values in terms of harmonic fundamental frequency omega and its multiples in omega naught. So this zero is nothing but omega naught. This is 1 into omega naught. This is 2 into omega naught. This is 3 into omega naught, and so on. So this here is actually a version, the frequency coefficients only represent in terms of fundamental frequency and its multiples. Okay. Now let us see a problem in contrast. So x of t was a problem which was a rectangular wave, sudden transition, lots and lots of frequencies. Whereas this particular signal you can see here, it is a sinusoid. Okay. Earlier signal was a rectangular signal. This is a sinusoid. So when I say sinusoid, sinusoid you generally contains how many frequencies? Now you can see here, a cos 2 pi fct. That's what the template. So this is containing only one frequency. When this particular signal is containing one frequency, we end up getting answer. And one more thing, whenever you get this kind of signals where you have been given the coefficients directly, you don't solve it by substituting in the exact formula, but rather you compare it. Rather you compare it with the standard expression to get the value, right? So here you can see, we have done this particular method. And what sort of values did we get here, by the way? We can see the answer what we got here, a cos wave, right? So answer we got here was impulse on the left side, impulse on the right side. Okay, so that's what we got. What was the wave, by the way? Cos wave, right? Okay, we ended up getting an impulse on the left and impulse on the right side, indicating that you just see the right side for the timing. There is one impulse on the right side. It means that there is one frequency. There is only one frequency. If at all there were two impulses on the right side, I would have said there are two frequencies. If at all there are three impulses on the right side, I would have said that there are three frequencies. Whereas for the previous rectangular case, there were lots and lots of frequencies. Remember, it had so many frequencies in it. Okay. Fine. This is a phase. So that was the problem. Then you can see here in this particular question also, there are two frequencies. Okay, there is one frequency here, one more frequency, rightly indicated. Okay, you can see rightly indicated by impulses. One impulse at 3, impulse at minus 3, impulse at 4 and minus 4. Okay, of course with different magnitudes. Okay, of course with different magnitudes. So that was about the Fourier series. Okay, that was about the Fourier series, and we have solved enough problems, I guess. So it's also the problem. Yeah. So okay, now that this is a video that's being broadcast, if at all you get doubt, you can just rewind forward and you can go through it. Okay. Yes, and here also you can see now how many frequencies are we talking about here. This also looks like a good well-behaved sinusoid, right? You can see sine pi t, right? It's a sinusoid, but then there is a problem. You can see there was a sinusoid, it would have continued like this, but you abruptly cut it, right? So when you do this abrupt cutting, so that's when lots and lots of frequencies are going to be introduced. Okay. So lots and lots of frequencies are going to be introduced. And you have discussed it. So whenever these kind of signals are given, which are not standard ones, but if at all you know how to represent them, so you just have to represent those signals and then afterwards simply integrate with the formula. You shall get the answer. Okay. So that was the problem. This is also one more problem, by the way. See, anything, if at all the signal is a sinusoid, like a well-behaved sine, cos, wave, then you get those impulses. If at all you get a rectangular, a triangular, or a sawtooth, then you are going to get lots and lots of values. There is no standard answer to this. If at all you are familiar with some answer in the textbook, fine, you can try to arrive at that. Otherwise, you should be, somehow you should get an expression for x of k, which should be, with which you should be able to substitute k in a calculator, and you should be able to get the value of x, which apparently see here, this cannot be done on calculator. So you should not, you should bring it to a form which shall let you substitute the value of k and help you find x of k. Okay, so this problem also we have discussed anyway in the class. That was another problem, and then this is one more problem. This also sawtooth, so this also abrupt changes. Okay, you can see here, no smooth transitions, abrupt changes. Abrupt changes means lots and lots of frequencies. Okay. Okay, then anything interesting, by the way, other than that, let us see any other problems. Yes, here there is one more interesting problem. What is this? Determine the time domain signal. Okay, so for this particular problem, what is the case? Determine the they have given x of k, the coefficient, and asked us to determine the time domain representation. As you can see, this contains impulses. There is an impulse at plus 1, there is an impulse at minus 1, there is an impulse at 3, there is an impulse at minus 3. One of them is having magnitude j, and the other one is minus j, and this one you can see is completely real. Remember, a cos usually has impulses, two impulses at k and minus k. Both are real, right? E to the power j theta plus e to the power minus j theta divided by 2, no j. Whereas for sine wave, it contains complex values, plus j and minus j. So this here has been aptly, you know, comparison is done with, and it has been concluded that, combining, okay, e to the power j theta plus e to the power minus j theta. Okay, so you have to have multiply and divide by 2 to get the standard form. E to the power j theta minus e to the power minus j theta divided by 2j, jj taken care to get a sine wave. Okay, so that was the method there. Similarly, another problem. Okay, something similar, another problem, something similar. Okay, that also. So I hope you might have got an idea. So what the advantage of Fourier representation is, it lets you know exactly how many frequencies are there in a signal, however weird the signal looks like. Okay, so we have seen signals like rectangular, signals like a sawtooth, right? There we could predict how many frequency components are there, neatly indicated by their magnitude and phase. Okay, so this particular thing what we got in the end, by the way, this particular thing is called a spectrum. Okay, whenever the x-axis is frequency and you get some magnitude and phase in terms of frequencies, so the term used is frequency spectrum. Okay, spectrum, whenever somebody says spectrum, draw the spectrum. So it is actually they are talking about the frequency response. Okay, they are talking about the frequency response, spectrum is written. So this one is representing the magnitude is called as magnitude spectrum, and this is called as phase spectrum. Okay. Then what? Okay, so here is an example by, okay, fine. Anything, any other thing interesting? Okay. So in this particular problem here, actually, you have been given an x of k, magnitude and phase, and you have been asked to find out x of t. Okay, so this kind of problem also has been discussed in the class, where we said that this 2 is magnitude, 2 into e to the power j pi by 4, right? 2 into e to the power j pi by 4, and this was 2 into e to the power j minus pi by 4, right? I think we have discussed, I remember discussing this particular problem. And while you are writing, you usually come from the extreme left side and go on moving to the right. That is where you can see that's the way it has been, from minus infinity to plus infinity. Okay, so those are the problems usually that you encounter in Fourier series. I don't see anywhere where you can go wrong unless there are the properties. The Fourier series comes with lots and lots of properties which will help you ease things. Okay, so what I have decided is I will not be touching the properties of Fourier series as of now. And properties are one of the reason why I have decided to skip the Fourier transformation and go to Z transform, then come back. Okay. So then let us talk about discrete time Fourier series. As I told you, not there in your syllabus, but just let us see what this particular thing here is. So one thing is sure. So this is the formula for discrete time Fourier series. Presence of a one by n indicates that this has to be periodic, right? So you're doing the, and then there is having a summation. Having a summation indicates that it should exist for discrete time signals only. And you can see to the inverse formula. This is the inverse discrete time Fourier series formula. Given the Fourier coefficients, how to get x of n back? It has a summation in it, right? In earlier expression for the continuous time Fourier series, we had an integration. That means this x of k, the discrete time Fourier series, is discrete time in nature. Okay, so this is also discrete time in nature, but you can see this particular thing here indicates that it is periodic. The discrete time Fourier series is periodic in nature. Okay, it is periodic in nature. Here is an example. So like in earlier, we started with a rectangular box, right? So this was the problem x of t which you took, and we asked you to find the Fourier series representation. Here we have something which is discrete in nature. We have something which is discrete and periodic in nature. So what is the period here? 4. 4 is the period. And how to solve this thing? Of course, the same formula. Here is the formula in which the values have been substituted to get a final expression. Now you go on substituting values of k. How many values? Earlier, remember I told you that you may have to substitute infinite values. Say I would set the 5 values on the right side, 5 values on the left side. You may have to substitute. Here, nothing like that. Here, what you have to do is you have to substitute only values as many as 4. After 4 values, the same values are going to repeat. That means x of 3 will be same as x of 3 plus 4. Okay, x of 2 will be same as x of 2 plus 4. Okay, that means after every 4 samples, the values keep on getting repeated. That means x of k, the discrete time Fourier series, is periodic in nature. Okay, is periodic in nature. Okay, so and similarly, discrete time Fourier series for a sinusoid, a cos wave. So what's the difference, by the way? Just like the previous case for cos wave, as I told you, I will get 2 impulses, one on the left and one on the right side. Here also I got the 2 impulses, one on the left and one on the right side. But you can see from the signal, it is revealed that the period of this particular wave is n is equal to 6. Okay. So what would happen here is, this is true from minus 6 to minus 2 to plus 3, minus 2 to 3. Then afterwards, the same pattern, you can see, same pattern keeps on getting repeating. If it was a continuous cos pi by 3t, then you'd have simply got only 2 impulses. Here, after every 6 samples, the 2 impulses, they keep on repeating. Okay, that is the difference in discrete time Fourier series. Okay, that is the difference in a discrete time Fourier series. Okay, so you can see similarly, there is a rectangular box. We had earlier problem, right? A rectangular box. This is also a rectangular box. Only thing is, this is a discrete time rectangular box. Okay. This is a discrete time rectangular box. Here also we take only one of the cycle and we do the analysis. Here also we take one of the cycles and we do the analysis to end up getting an expression. Let us see how does it look like. So finally, here also you can see sine divided by sine form only, as expected. Here also we got a expression. Here also we got a expression. Okay. So that was about discrete time Fourier series. As I told you, I have not keen on this particular thing. Okay. Now, so what are the Fourier series methods, by the way? So there were continuous time Fourier series and discrete time Fourier series. So here are the expressions. Okay, so and here is the analogy. Okay, so you can see continuous time Fourier series exists for continuous time signals. This one exists for discrete time signals. This one is aperiodic. This one you can see, this particular thing keeps on repeating. So you can see the same pattern has started repeating here on the right side, repeating here on the left side. On the left side. Okay. Then anything else? Approaches, yes, fine. Okay. Now let us talk about what we are going to do next. Okay. So after Fourier series, the actual topic that we are supposed to discuss was Fourier transforms. Okay. The topic that we are supposed to discuss was Fourier transforms, which heavily uses the various properties, okay, to solve most of the problems and to derive the related results. So I thought before going to that, let us cover Z transforms. This Z transform here is applicable for much wider range of signals. Okay, so what is this Z transforms all about? So this constitutes module 5 of your syllabus. Okay, so what we'll be doing is, after this we are done with the module which you are, okay, we'll be going to module 5, then we'll come back to module 4. Okay, so what is this particular thing? Z transform is representation of signals using discrete time complex exponentials. Okay, so Z transform is about representing signal in terms of discrete time complex exponential. What was Fourier series, by the way? Fourier series was a representation of periodic signals. Remember, this Z transform is representation of aperiodic signals. Okay, Z transform, let me tell you, is representation of aperiodic signals. All the transforms are representation of aperiodic signals. Series are the representations for periodic signals, by the way, using discrete time complex exponentials. So we have seen complex exponentials, right? E to the power j theta. Okay, those are the complex exponentials. So earlier in Fourier series, we are representing everything in the e to the power j k omega naught, right? So in terms of complex exponentials, okay, k into omega naught, 2k into omega naught. Here, discrete time complex exponentials. What are they? Why are you studying in the introductory chapter? We studied, right? Suppose r into, let us see, what is a complex sinusoid? R to the power n. Say, if at all I have r to the power n, this is called as complex sinusoid, where r is equal to a into e to the power j theta, some constant e to the power j theta. Okay. Let us see this particular Z transform, what this thing is. So just like we had the Laplace transform for the continuous time signals, Laplace transform, just like we had for continuous time aperiodic signals, for discrete time periodic signals, we have Z transform. Let us just quickly see what all things are we going to learn here, and from the next class onwards we'll start this particular thing. So why study Z transform, by the way? Z transform is the discrete time counterpart of Laplace transform. That means what all things that Laplace transform would allow us to do for continuous time signals and systems, Z transform is allowing us to do the same sorts of things, but for discrete time signals and systems. What sort of things? Study the system characteristics. What sort of characteristics, by the way? Stability, causality, memory, right? System properties, basically system properties, IO behavior. Okay, it's allowing us to do that. Derivation of computational structures for implementing the systems on computers. Okay, so given a transfer function, given a impulse response, maybe. Okay, so impulse response can be h of t, which is for continuous time systems. Impulse response can be h of n. Now this one is for discrete time systems. You might have seen this h of t, if at all you take h of s, the Laplace transform, you can represent it in terms of the block diagram representation, right, which is an implementation approach. Similarly here, this, if at all I take it and take the z transform of this, it's going to help me get a very, very simplified implementation structure. Okay, implementation structure for the discrete time system on digital computers. Okay, which can be implemented in labs also, which can be implemented on computers also by writing suitable expressions. Okay, and it's also going to allow me to solve the difference equation subject to initial conditions. You might remember, you might have used this Laplace transformation to solve the differential equations, right? For discrete time signals, instead of differential equations, we have something called as difference equations. Okay, and for such difference equations, to solve those, we need Z transform. Okay, we need Z transform. Okay, now let us what sort of things we'll be studying here. You can see this is a formula of a typical Z transform. Okay, you can see x of n into earlier, remember the formula, x of n e to the power minus j k omega naught n. That was the formula, remember, in case of Fourier. Now here you can see x of 0 into z to the power minus 0, x of 1 into z to the power minus 1, x of 2 into z to the power minus 2. That means what you are doing is, you are trying to represent the signal x of n in terms of these values. Okay, you can see here, now our signal x of n is being represented in terms of z. Okay, in terms of the complex exponential z and its weighted superpositions. Okay, z and its weighted superposition. And you can see there is an integration term here, a circular integration, which indicates that the discrete, the Z transform what we have is going to be a sort of a circle. Okay, it's going to be something like this. Okay, that's weird, right? Let us see, as another time comes in, we will also see that. One thing is for sure, X of N is discrete time in nature. X of Z what we have exists as a circle, with a definite radius, and it exists having a points on this particular circular plane. Okay, that's how it is going to be. Much simpler concept, by the way. And there is one more thing, that if at all I simply replace z by e to the power j omega, I end up getting the discrete time Fourier transform. Okay, this is also one more reason why I am studying, why I am teaching Z transform first. Once you learn every Z transform, then by simply substituting Z by e to the power j omega, most of the things can be extended to Fourier transforms also, the discrete time Fourier transform also. Similarly, let me tell you that continuous time Fourier transform, if at all simply replace S in the Laplace transform, simply S by j omega, you end up getting the Laplace transform, continuous time Fourier transform. Okay, you replace Z by e to the power j omega, you get discrete time Fourier transform. You replace S by j omega in the Laplace transform, you get continuous time Fourier transform. Okay, so whatever the knowledge of your Fourier transform which you studied earlier, Laplace transform, sorry, is going to come in very handy here also. Okay. And there are some very interesting formulas that Z transform helps us out in solving much of the problems. So something like, what sort of properties, by the way, we are talking about, say here, we'll be studying some properties of the operator. What is the utility of us converting the data from time domain to Z domain? So there are certain properties. Say the operator is linear in nature. Okay, we are not talking about the system in general, we are talking about the operation. the Z transformation operation is linear in nature. Linear is fine, but there are some other properties also. See it now. What properties? There is this one here. Yeah, this is the property we are all very much interested in. We studied convolution, right? Convolution is a complex thing. Okay, there is one thing. You take something in taking the Z transform of the first operator, take something in taking Z transform of the second operator, then what's going to happen is the whole lot of pain you would sustain in doing the convolution will be eased by the fact that you just have to do a multiplication. So the whole transformation converts the convolution into multiplication. So of course there is a complexity involved here, there is a complexity involved here, but then this particular overhead greatly reduces the whole process of convolution to a simple multiplication. Okay, so that is why the advantages of the transformation are overcome by the disadvantages of taking pain in doing transformation are overcome by the simplicity with which the convolution can be done by doing a simple multiplication. So this is the reason why we are into all, actually, even this was true with Laplace transforms. You might have studied in mathematics, but you did not know what is this convolution and all. Okay, but you have studied in mathematics that Laplace transform also converts convolution into multiplication. Fourier also converts convolution to multiplication, and Z transform also converts convolution to multiplication. Okay. So I think these many reasons are sufficient for us to be much more motivated to study Z transforms. Okay. So from tomorrow's class, that means from next class, we'll be doing introduction to Z transform. Okay. We'll be doing the introduction to Z transform. Very interesting topic, by the way. So it is like whatever that is happening in control systems, right? Whatever you are trying to do in the control systems, the stability analysis and all those things, we will be doing something in parallel for discrete time systems. Okay. Whatever that is you are doing in control system, you can see in control system mostly you will see x of t and h of ss. Here you will see x of n and h of z. Okay. And then Fourier is in there in both. Okay. So let me just stop now. Okay. So when we meet in the next class, we'll be talking about the Z transforms. Okay. Thanks for joining. Bye.